Soweto will be joining us after the replay of the album. He was on his way back from Germany. He gigged last night, and his flight was slightly delayed. So you are getting two presentations. As we say in America, you're getting more bang for your buck. So what can we say? John has kindly offered to introduce this album, the Joe Harriott Quintet Abstract. I wanted to talk to you about when it came out in 1962. This is one of the pioneering albums of British freeform jazz. But what was the jazz landscape like in the early 1960s in Britain?
This is sort of the early 60s when I first started listening to the music, I guess. So this was like, I was a teenager. There was an interesting dynamic in those days because there was a kind of, it was around the time of a traditional jazz revival where there were British traditional jazz bands like Kenny Bolk, Acker Bilt, Chris Barber, et cetera, Humphrey Littleton, who were charting. So this was popular music. Until Liverpool took over, and there were stories of the traditional jazz bands being shifted to being the headline band to being the interval band when they were on tour. So there's a lot of background there, but there was also a very vibrant modern jazz scene that had grown up since the 40s. There was all sorts of dynamic between the traditional jazz world and the modern jazz world, bebop and hard bop and so on. And actually, it got down to kind of riots at the Bewley Jazz Festival. It got down to the fact that when Humphrey Littleton, a friend of mine actually was at this concert in Birmingham Town Hall when Humphrey Littleton introduced a saxophone into what had been seen as being a traditional jazz line, and there were banners went up saying, "Go home, dirty bopper."
I mean,
it was
wow.
Serious. It was quite kind of. There was this kind of contrast, in a sense. And there were two. And the styles were very different in a way. The visual style, the dress of the modern jazz players and audience was very different from the traditional jazz players, for example. So there was. I think that was certainly a kind of a broad brush. Landscape, but it's interesting that when an artist like we were also seeing at that time the beginning of how an African, Caribbean, and then Asian culture was beginning to take root in the UK in a much more fundamental sense. And so, in a way, when we started to look at the program for this year's festival, this playing this album connects into a much bigger theme around the arrival of the Windrush 70 years ago, and. Joe Harriott was a little later than that. He arrived in 1951. He very quickly became established on the bebop circuit and was making records with people like Tony Kinsey and the whole generation of British modern jazz players that had grown up listening to Charlie Parker and Dizzy Gillespie and Miles Davis and so on. So, but he also connected back into a Caribbean culture. So when you look at the personnel of Abstract and his quintet at that time, it was rather interestingly, it was a trumpeter called Sheikh Keane, who's quite a significant figure in Caribbean culture. He was a minister of culture, and I can't actually remember. I should have checked this beforehand whether he was St. Vincent or St. Lucia.
He's from St. Vincent.
Yeah, and he was also a poet, a respected poet and writer. And Coleridge Good, of course, who reached 100 a few years ago, he's passed away, but he arrived as an engineering student in Glasgow in the 30s and became a bass player who was playing right across the scene in the UK. But the two other players were a Scottish piano player, Pat Smythe, who was kind of influenced by Bill Evans, I guess, and that sort of genre of jazz piano. And originally a drummer called Phil Seaman, who was always a larger than life character. There's a whole program that could be done around Phil Seaman.
Really? Yeah. Interesting.
Many stories. But he was a larger than life character who had his own demons actually, but was an unbelievable drummer. The other drummer was a Scottish guy called Bobby Orr.
And didn't he teach Ginger Baker drums?
That's right. He ended up running a band called Air Force. I saw them playing together with Air Force. It was like two drummers. Mm-hmm. They were both completely crazy.
Now, when this album came out, you got a copy and you were just a teenager, weren't
you?
Yeah,
I must have been like 15 or 16 maybe at the time.
Did it blow your mind?
Well, I read about it. And it, remarkably, this album got, for a European or non-American jazz record, got a five-star review in the American kind of the, you know, magazine Downbeat, which is the jazz bible. And for that to take root at that time, that was a pretty important statement, actually. And this music was running between a kind of hard bop background, bebop background, but then Joe Harriott had this sense of wanting to open out the time. And one of the reasons we wanted to bring it into this program was because King's Place has been running this program called Time Unwrapped, and this idea that that jazz was beginning to explore not only different time signatures, which Dave Brubeck was doing, but also was opening out the rhythm, so and really exploring areas of free music that then became quite significant during the evolution of the music in the 60s. The late 50s, Harriott started to explore this, and also using a lot of this kind of Caribbean feel about a lot of his music as well. He was exploring it around the same time as Ornette Coleman and Don Cherry and Charlie Hayden and Ed Blackwell were beginning to look at the same area of work, and Jimmy Giuffre actually in the States as well. But remarkably, they didn't really connect with each other, I don't think, from what we can tell. And it was the Joe Harriott's approach, the band approach, was different. It was much more, of a kind of collective ebb and flow.
Thank you.
Now, what was the response of the British jazz establishment to this album? You said it got a 5-star review in Downbeat, the American Jazz Bible. But how about over here? What was the response? I mean, this is so different to trad jazz.
Very. And I think it was, and different from more conventional bebop, actually. I mean, it was really kind of exploring new territory in quite a profound way. And Joe himself was, you know, there was an intellectual quality as well that kind of thought it through. He himself had an interest in abstract art. So this was kind of connected in that way. But I think it was also, I mean, it's interesting. I was trying to remember in the sense that it was, because, you know, you're a teenager at that time, you didn't really kind of get into the real depths.
Right.
But my memory is that I was drawn to buy the record because I read about it in either Jazz Journal or Jazz Monthly or sold a Melody Maker or something. And it was controversial because it was breaking through. But there was an audience for it as well. I mean, I did actually see this band play live at the Edinburgh Festival in the early 60s. And it was placed in the context of a show that was exploring Caribbean culture. So they were playing repertoire around Caribbean artists that were other vocalists and poets that were part of this, but they were also able to play their own music. So he was playing some of the free repertoire at the same time. So actually, and the you could see an audience being kind of intrigued by this.
Puzzled or intrigued?
It was also not necessarily, I don't think it was actually, I mean, there were a couple of players that were working with him in a more conventional sense who couldn't run with him, that left the band, in effect.
He did work with a lot of different kinds of people, too, though. He did work with Chris Barber, talking about trad jazz a bit later in his career, and he worked with musicians from India, I believe.
Well, I always feel that the great jazz musicians have got this quality of this sense of restlessness, that they a creative restlessness. So they're always looking for a different, you know, for something that they can also, something new to explore. Mm-hmm. And I think he was very much consistent. I mean, you look at the career of Miles Davis, it's an exact kind of that's what Miles' career always was. It was continually looking for fresh creativity and fresh ideas. So I think Joe was very similar to that. And he forged this relationship with John Mayer, who was an Indian classical violinist. And Indo-Jazz Fusions was a pretty important band of its time. It was really way ahead of its time. Thank you.
I'm going to ask you a few more questions before we listen to the album, and then Soweto is going to join us after the album. We'll have another presentation and also a Q&A with him. But as we are going to listen to the album in a few minutes, can you tell us what to listen out for? Like, how do we hear these Caribbean influences, or what are the things we should be listening out for as we're taking in this record?
I think it's the fact that the group playing is it, the interaction within the group, and the fact that he creates these moods in the music, the kind of sense of exploring, a bit like an abstract painter is trying to create a sense that's of an image that can mean different things to different people, actually. And I think there's that sense of texture between the instruments and the balance between the instruments, and the way that he's encouraging them to listen to each other and then react to each other is very important, actually. And I think there's some rhythmic things that you every now and then you catch a calypso, or you catch a different rhythmic pattern coming through. Mm-hmm. And some of it is very abstract, and some of it's actually quite groove-based.
It's interesting how you're speaking about it using visual terms as well, and I can see how the influence of modern art and abstract art would have maybe been influencing his own music, as you alluded to before. One last question for you before we listen to the album. What do you think is Joe Harriott's legacy, and what do you think is this album's legacy? Why is it so important?
Well, I think it stood the test of time. I think that's for sure. I mean, to me, it still sounds fresh and still sounds like it's sense of being on a journey. Mm-hmm. So I think that's important. I think the other side of it is that actually here was an artist from the Caribbean making a big statement, right, at, you know, 10 years within a decade of arriving in the UK and changing the way that people listened to jazz and to music. And then a few years later with Indo-Jazz fusions, really doing the same thing, actually connecting two new communities within the UK and making a statement that's an important part of our culture. Mm-hmm. So actually, for me, I think his legacy is very much, I think Soweto, I'm sure, will talk more about this later, because I mean, I think his importance in terms of that story, the story of a changing multicultural country, is really important.
Well, we'll definitely be picking up on that with him. John, thank you so much for joining us and introducing this album. Please give a hand to John Cumming, founder of EFG London Jazz Festival.
Thank you.
Thank you.
spoke a bit about the landscape of British jazz in the early 1960s and what this must have sounded like when it came out. You were there. You had bought a copy of the album. Gets the 5-star review in Downbeat. But we didn't talk about what was actually happening in America at the time, because a lot of people think that they put Ornette Coleman into the same kind of category as Joe Harriott. But you and I were speaking, and I believe that he was a bit unaware of what was going on in the U.S. with Ornette at the time.
I'm not sure how. It's very difficult to tell, I guess, because it's like, certainly Ornette's records were beginning to be released over here and so on, but it was being talked about. But whether certainly from my point, from my listening, but I think also from a number of people, although there was a lot of quite lazy, I would say, criticisms being, or comparisons being made. Actually, I don't know how people felt when listening to it, but to me, what this music is very different from the way that Ornette was playing, because there was a lot more solo statements in the way that Ornette was constructing the music, and mm-hmm. it felt it was coming from a very different place. Mm-hmm. And it's difficult to tell how much. I'm sure it wasn't. I'm sure Ornette wasn't hearing Joe Harriott. That's for sure.
Right.
And I'm not actually sure how much Joe Harriott would have really absorbed of Ornette at that time, because he was beginning to evolve this in the late 50s. So as far as one can tell. So it's like, I think it's interesting that it's coming from a different place.
Mm-hmm. I mean, freeform jazz can be kind of. Could it be anything, actually? I mean, there's different interpretations both in the UK and the US.
Well, there's another interesting point. I suppose that also in the States, Jimmy Giuffre was beginning to explore all this in the early 60s as well, and that was coming from another different corner. But in Europe, this was much more underground, I guess, but the work that that Derek Bailey was evolving with Tony Oxley and Gavin Bryars in the early 60s, which was coming from the north of England, really. They were kind of, both Derek and Tony were from Yorkshire, and I think Gavin as well, actually. But they were coming from a different corner completely. And there was, as the 60s went on, you started to hear a very European approach to free improvisation, which was partly influenced by listening to Coltrane and Albert Eiler and so on and Ornette, but it was also coming from a very strongly European, British and European, because there were European players as well.
And do you think that Joe Harriott would have had a bigger impact had he been in America releasing Abstract in 1962?
Almost certainly. Yeah. I think that's. I mean, in those days, there was still this sense, I guess, that America was the African American jazz tradition was where it was where it came from, and for obvious reasons.
But it seems to have more authenticity, maybe, to I'm not saying it did, but
I think in terms of international impact, I mean, you certainly when you look at the international touring circuit, for instance, it was very dominated by Americans. I don't think that, there was quite a, there were a period, odd British bands did make it, for instance, to Newport. I mean, John Dankworth did. Actually, Eric Delaney, the drummer, dance band drummer, really, I think played Newport Jazz Festival as well.
Now, Joe Harriott as a personality, you said you saw him perform live. What kind of personality was he? You would have had to have had a lot of conviction to release an album like this in 1962, because it is still quite challenging, I think, even now.
I met him a couple of times. I did a gig, at least one gig with him when I was in Edinburgh at University, the University Jazz Club, and he was pretty forthright in a sense. I mean, he was a very reasonable guy, but he was also, from what I remember, but he was also very clear. I mean, he did give the rhythm section that he was playing in Edinburgh a pretty tough time. And he was, hearing the music, this music was complex, mm-hmm. and very, the playing is technically pretty advanced as well.
Mm-hmm. Now, yes, he's very fast, obviously. Now, growing up, he was born in Jamaica and then moving over here, we could hear some of these influences in there. I could actually hear it more of it in the percussion, really. Mm. We should talk about some of the other players. There was Shake Keane on trumpet. Can you talk a little bit about him?
He was part of a community, actually, that was, I think there was, the the community of the Caribbean community was quite close, actually. And I think, as you'd imagine, from a you know, coming to a new country and so on. And I think he was a poet and writer. I think we touched on this beforehand. And I think that you are also seeing that sense of a really cultured community coming in that had a very broad picture of what they were doing. It was the writers and the poets were interacting with the musicians and so on. And I think they were quite mutually supportive, maybe. Mm-hmm. You feel that. And I think that association between Sheikh Keane and Joe Harriott and Coleridge actually was very close. And there was the critic and the writer and photographer Val Wilmer has done an awful lot of work around this, and it's fascinating. The story is very is fascinating, actually. I think he was a very significant figure in himself, and they also interacted with. There were other British players that they began to work with, like Don Rendell and Ian Carr and Michael Garrick, who became part of. There was that community as well of British musicians who were beginning to extend the boundaries of simply deriving their music from the American models, but started to look at composing in a different way.
Mm-hmm. Now, I didn't touch upon this before the album because I thought it was quite of a sad story, but Joe Harriott, towards the end of his life, he wasn't really living a great existence, I think is the best way of putting it. So could you talk a little bit about his remaining career?
Well, I think I know that he ended up in...
Hey, he made it! Just
Here. I could do a bit of...
You have a seat.
We could do a bit of a relay. Yes. Yeah, we could.
Back and forth.
He kind of ended up in poverty, really, and destitute in Southampton, of all places. And he was, coincidentally, I'd moved to work in the south of England and started to find out some of the jazz scene around the south coast. And there was I met a guy called Skip Conway, who ran the Southampton Jazz Society, who was a very committed disabled man, actually, very resilient man, and he was really looking after Joe in his final years. And he finally died in early 73, I think, of cancer. But and he's buried in Southampton. But it was a slow decline, actually, because I think when I worked with him in Edinburgh, it must have been in maybe 69 or something like that. But he was really at that point doing gigs with local rhythm sections. And it was, you know, when you think of the career, the trajectory that went through the 50s to this music and then on to Indo-Jazz fusions and a lot of other things as well.
Probably already mentioned it, that it's the first album to receive a 5-star downbeat poet, to then sleeping on people's couches, getting a sciatica, which led to all the other health complications and, you know, so it was this tragic arc. Thank you.
Festival. Welcome, hey. Soweto. Please.
Thanks for having me. Sorry I'm late, guys.
Thank you for coming.
Would have been here a lot earlier if I could have helped it.
Go, John, because I know you have a lot of other gigs to go to. I think you have to head over to the bar again.
Thank you for doubling.
I'm going to switch places with you.
Cheers.
Thank you, John. Thank you. Okay, so we talked quite a bit about, John really set the stage for the album. We listened to the album, but I want to talk to you from your perspective,
sure.
because he was there when the album came out.
Yeah.
You obviously weren't.
I wasn't. Not as old as I look.
So how did he discover Joe Harriott?
I came across him working with Gary Crosby, and uncovering, I guess, a world of West Indian-born, British-based musicians, Wilton Guinier, Harold McNair, Dizzy Reese, many of Joe Harriott's contemporaries, and a generation before that of Bertie King and Leslie Hutchison. So I was always kind of keen to uncover this otherwise obscured history, I guess, of a British West Indian presence in jazz. And it was quite an obscure recording that really lit my touch paper at first. Recording that Michael Garrick himself put out, which was almost Joe Harriott jamming along to Jamie Abersold tapes or playing standards into a dictaphone, when I realized the Indo-Jazz fusions and the abstract stuff was merely just a sliver of what his capacities were on the saxophone and his knowledge, you know, of jazz.
And what was it like when you first listened to this album, Abstract? Did it blow you away?
Yeah, actually, I'd say it was on a second or third listen, and actually in transcribing it, that the depth and the richness of the music really started to unfurl itself. So I'd say, yes, it is shocking in the same way, in some ways, he probably made these comparisons earlier, as some Ornette Coleman or some American freeform music. But there was something so distinctive in the way he'd phrase stuff, in the way that the songs are written. I guess you had a chance to listen, and so much of it sounds like fanfares and things which are maybe more, West Indian ears might be more acclimatized, certainly British subjects' ears, perhaps, to hearing those militaristic sounds and fanfare-like things. But also the influence of abstract art is very clear in the way that he writes music.
Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Sure.
We just touched upon that, because
sure.
even you look at the album cover, which is absolutely gorgeous as well, but we touched upon about how he was really into poetry, but we went just a tiny bit into art. Mm. So he was really into abstract art.
Absolutely, he was a Picasso fan, as much as he was a Charlie Parker fan. He would frequently go to art galleries and opine on really what the place of postmodernism was and visual arts and how that could have an impact on his creativity. So I think that was really the bedrock, the seed corn ideas of the freeform music that later evolved. It wasn't a purely musical impetus, if you like. I think he was keen to break free of the confines of 4-4 time and the set chord procedures, and abstract art, I guess the revolution that had occurred, and as I said, particularly with Picasso and his interest there, that revolution really set a precedent for him musically.
There's a lot of ties between abstract art in late 50s and early 1960s jazz, and even like John Coltrane's cover for Blue Train is supposed to be based on Picasso's Blue Period, maybe by the graphic designer rather than Coltrane himself.
Yeah.
We were talking about this earlier also with Dave Brubeck and the cover of Time Out and S. Neil Fujita, who was the head
right,
of art.
That's right, amazing. Yeah, Blue Note, yeah.
Absolutely beautiful, and Mingus Ahams as well. So I really see so many ties, how that everyone's just trying to break boundaries and whatever their discipline is, which is incredible.
I think there's something that sets Harriott apart, actually, and something of a Renaissance man. I think given his really humble background, which I'm sure we've discussed as well.
Well, we haven't discussed his background.
Wow.
I mean, I know
okay.
he's from Jamaica. He came over here in 1951, but we haven't really discussed his background.
He grew up in an orphanage in the famous Alpha Boys School, which has produced people that I've been lucky enough to work with. Edward Tantan George, Eddie Tantan George, trumpet player who plays in Jazz Jamaica. But the alumni of Alpha Boys School, which was the orphanage in Kingston, which produced so many of these luminaries, includes Don Drummond, Tommy McCook, I believe. So, I mean, legends really in the evolution of Jamaican music and ska more widely. But Joe Harriott, I would consider probably the most prodigiously gifted jazz improviser to have emerged from that school. And from all accounts, from the things that Tantan himself told me, he was a fully formed jazz beast by the time he joined Ozzy DaCosta's band and came to England in 1958. So he was a fully evolved, hungry jazz Turk, you know, young lion.
Now, it seems that Joe Harriott, I get the impression that he inspires you both musically and personally. So first, can we talk about how he has inspired you musically? Because I want to talk about the legacy now.
I mean, musically, that uncompromising streak in everything that he did, the fact that you feel there was an artistic bent that led every single project that he did, be that Indo-Jazz fusions, it was something that was heard, not, this is a great funding opportunity, or this is a, you know, something that's going to be commercially hugely successful. I think he was led in every single direction that he took by some burning internal sense of creativity. So that's the first one. I'd say he clearly had a massive ego, but he was prepared to forge really long-standing relationships and friendships with musicians that mattered to him. Frank Holder, Shake Keen, the people that we hear on the record. Now, Frank, luckily, is another one that I've been fortunate enough to meet. I don't know if John mentioned that. But
I know that he's an inspiration to you. I've read that.
One of the reasons I'm playing the music today.
Oh, really? How's that? Tell us that story.
So my father's a playwright. He took a play of his up to the Edinburgh Festival. And in that cast was Frank Holder and Will Gaines, rest in peace. So Will Gaines is a hoofer, Frank Holder, great vocalist and jazz percussionist, as we've heard on the record. And he was just so encouraging, so embracing. He's like, you want to play jazz? Let's busk. So we went busking in Edinburgh for like a week. And I learned so much about the spirit of the music through that. But, you know, Frank has told me about his times with Joe Harriott. And there's an intensity, an uncompromising, unrelenting nature to the way that Joe Harriott created music, but also a warm embrace that could make you realize, as members of his band, a mixed race band as well, draw attention to that, you knew that you were in the presence of something great, something truly magnificent.
And how important is it to you to now to kind of uncover some of these artists that may have fell a little bit by the wayside on a mainstream level, especially those of Caribbean heritage? I mean, how important is that to you to kind of resurrect their
reputation?
It's
hugely important.
Why is that?
There's another part of this which I'll go back to as well, which is how he's personally, not just musically, affected me. But, let me just get to that quickly. There's something, the quote that I can't really get out of my head, which is so typically Joe Harriott. You probably may have heard this or not. I'm not your equal, or I don't want to be considered your equal. I am your superior. That's just
a lot of bravado.
Yeah. Classically Jared, but this is somebody, as I said, you consider his background. He's grown up in an orphanage with aspirations to be an elite, to be a virtuosi on the level that nobody else can attain, to be the best in the world at what he did. So that's a Promethean sense of ambition, really, from those sort of humble beginnings. And I identify with that quite profoundly, because there's two ways to deal when you sort of intersect white racism or the British establishment. There are two sort of responses that you can have, which is sort of cower and supplicate and be like, yeah, please just give me a gig. Or to be like, nah, you might not get it now. You might not understand me in my lifetime, and be damned if I don't really care. I'm going to make music because I really believe in it, and those people who I consider valuable. You can see his superiority complex, if you like, exhibited in the music,
So that's been inspiring to you, and it's very important to you to kind of uncover these artists and to expose them to the greater British public.
Absolutely. And there's a lineage, I think you could look every 30 or 40 years, we're discovering, there's recently a talk about Samuel Coleridge Taylor again, and the fact that he had a successful 30-year running West End musical at the Royal Albert Hall, and he's sort of just been erased from British memory somehow. Somebody that Elgar considered a great composer. George Bridgetower, Joseph Emedy, hundreds of years, if you like, of black creatives in Britain who, for whatever reason, have been sort of airbrushed out. So it's very important, because you don't want to feel as a black British creative yourself that you're reinventing the wheel or that you're somehow out of context. There is precedent, there's antecedent, and Britain has looked a lot more diverse than we know for a very long time. So some people think black people came out last season with the latest, I don't know.
I asked John earlier what he thought the legacy of this album was. What do you think is a musical legacy, being a musician yourself? What is this, where do you hear this, and where do you hear Joe Harriott now?
Huge question. I think, firstly, the legacy of it is showing you what aspirations, as I mentioned, what lofty and artistically pure, the sort of integrity that existed in a core of jazz musicians in Britain at the time, I would never have known. Mm-hmm. John alluded to some of the pickup bands that he was playing with towards the end of his life, but I've got a couple of those records that he managed to record as bootlegs with Tony Levin and musicians like that. So there's a huge archival value to what he did as well, to say, Courtney Pine, Steve Williamson weren't the first. I'm not the first. Tony Kofi's not the first. Actually, there's this really uniquely British and Caribbean story in Joe Harriott. And thirdly, what he's bequeathed. In genre terms, would we have anything called world music in quite the same form if it wasn't for Indo-Jazz fusions? And again, it was easy to forget that these were huge, hugely successful records, at least, critically, they're a critical reception. What then happened afterwards is an interesting subject for maybe further discussion. He gets downbeat poll winners, 5-star reviews for one album. Indo-Jazz Fusions is well received, it's kind of premiere, but then it doesn't have a longer touring life. And we could probably wax lyrical about how difficult it is for people of color, working class people, women, to get a trajectory, to get a body of work that sustains a period of time, as opposed to a flash in the pan.
Yeah, to get that sustained support. Support.
Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you.
it's time to hand the microphone over to our listeners here. Do you have any questions of your own? We have a roving microphone just about to make its way over to you. Oh, don't be shy. I can't really see. Oh, we have a hand over there. I can't see too well because we have the spotlight on. Here's a mic there.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Oh, I see.
Thank
you.
Whether you, how you understand the process by which he created this album. I mean, it's got sort of strong form and strong surprises, but how did he plan it? I mean, there's a lot of interaction.
Yeah.
Is that directed or?
Great question. It's a mixture, from what I can gather, the anecdotes that I picked up. There's a great story from the recording of Freeform, the companion album, which I should also recommend you check out, where Pat Smythe was, let me get this right, Coleridge Good, or someone was tinkering around with a milk bottle and a spoon. Ding, ding. And Pat picked up on it and just started jamming along with it, and that became a whole piece. And I think the milk bottle made its way onto the recording somehow. So there was a receptiveness within that group to music, to hearing things, and an openness to that concept of abstraction that wouldn't have been there in every band setting. You know, you hear these stories when John Coltrane could just sort of walk into his quartet and start playing and they'd all just make songs up together. I get the impression there was that level of synergy, trust and love between all the members of, particularly this band. But yeah, I think there were many other methods as well. And I think he was very keen to establish the spirit and energy of a piece in the first 4 to 8 measures. Some of them just swing so hard. It's hard to put into words until you're playing them, that you think you want to count them off or that need a specific tempo. But the minute you play the first phrase, everybody's just naturally in. You know, and I think that's something very much in the design and the concept that Joe Harriott forged. But then after that, it's a point of departure. It's a very solid point of departure. And in that way, it differs from the avant-garde music of Ornette Coleman or of Eric Dolphy, for that matter. There's an initial statement, an initial burst of, here I am, and then it can go anywhere. And that, you know, relies on the love and the trust. I mean, give it up for Shake Keane as well. He's another one. Oof, wow. So I was thankfully listening to the record on the headphones on the way in again. But it's amazing how much virtuosity there is in it, and freedom. And that's only possible when there's trust. So on the one hand, he must have been quite a dictatorial band leader to get the results that he did, but also quite accommodating to allow the musicians to shine as much as they did too.
Great question, great answer. Any other questions? Don't be intimidated.
Don't be shy. Come on.
Don't be shy. Oh, great, there's 2 more. Yeah, I'm here.
Straightforward question. I probably missed when this album was created, and also who was the pianist on it? But just a statement too. I've got an album, October Woman, by Michael Garrick, and you should see the influence of these guys on that. Huge. Of course, half the band was in it, but you know.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's 1961 or 59? 62. Okay, and then Freeform before this.
Yeah, my notes.
Thank you. Yeah. Good job you got them. So it happens, actually. It's almost like an epiphany, I think, he has after a bout of tuberculosis. He'd been ill for a while, recovered from that. And I think that might explain some of his risk-taking in music as well. Often as jazz musicians, we just don't know how long we've got left. We could be sitting on the literally edge of our seats wondering what kind of statements we're going to get to make. So I think that might have informed his risk-taking approach to this new album. Pat Smythe was the pianist on the album. I think those are relationships that have probably been forged, you know, through the scene in London or in ways that they sound like friends on the album, basically. They don't sound like they're in competition. They certainly don't sound like a pickup band. So, you know, there's a lot to be said, I think, for the way that Joe would have brought those musicians together and assembled different personalities. I mean, the legendary stories of Phil Seaman being a bit of a chemist, a pharmaceutical horticulturalist. But you say there are, you know, a wide range of personalities and egos in the same room. And it maybe it took someone of Harriott's magnitude and genius to be able to knit all that together. And Michael Garrick, I've had the pleasure of talking to about it, and Coleridge Good, who should be taught on national syllabuses. Let me just quickly put in a word for Coleridge Good. He invented the pickup for double bass. He moved from Jamaica to Glasgow in the 1930s, and we just don't know about him. He, you know, just about still with us in Ladbroke Grove. And we don't celebrate these heroes while they're still with us, so that's really important. But Coleridge is a really loving, really accommodating. I can't imagine him ever getting into an argument with anyone. Michael Garrick is a lot more of a fiery character. it says a lot about, I think, particularly the freeform type of jazz innovation that Joe Harriott made, that all of these musicians, Art Thiemann, anybody that got into the concept could find space to be themselves in.
There's another question over here.
Oh yeah, actually, sorry, it's not really a question, it was a statement. And you just alluded to it. I'd listened to the album a number of times before, and I actually agree what you were saying. I don't really see, apart from the fact it's free jazz, much connection with Ornette Coleman. But listening to it today, I thought I heard Eric Dolphy might have fitted well in there. And
yep.
I had not really considered before. You just mentioned actually probably not, I thought. But what do you think? Because I love Eric Dolphy. And I just thought, yeah, he would have
different
gone and played with him nicely.
Great question. So it is a different concept, but I could understand why sonically it would be very similar. Because Bird... because of Charlie Parker, I think, is basically the template that they're both starting with. Dolphy's aspirations were to be principal oboist, and so he had some very 20th century atonal classical ambitions that were well ahead of his time. But his concept was based on Birdsong, on the cacophony of New York street sounds, human conversation, the insanity of it. So you could be, you know, forgiven for thinking Eric Dolphy couldn't play his horn if you're just hearing it for the first time. It's deliberately confusing. Harry, on the other hand, what I think he's done is congealed and collected a whole lot of knowledge about Charlie Parker. I don't think there are many other cats in his generation who could play the language of Charlie Parker as convincingly, which is why Charlie Mingus hired him, which is why the Modern Jazz Quartet used him when they were on tour in Britain. But then what he went on to do with that is to sort of strip it down and let the phrasing, let the expressions of all the transcription that he'd done of Charlie Parker become something else. So it wasn't necessarily about atonality. It wasn't necessarily about replicating sounds around us. It was the pure human cries, you know, as opposed to a fully fledged brushstroke spatter, more Jackson Pollock than Titian. I don't know if that works. But it's impressionism, if you like, as opposed to anything else, you know.
Thank you. question, but actually it was a homage to Joe Harriott. In my student days in London, I was taking to a jazz concert where Joe Harriott played.
Wow.
I was a member of the Jazz Center Society, shows you how long ago that was. Now, I listened to Joe Harriott one evening, and shortly after that, I was traveling, it's very clear in my mind now, on the number 73, going towards Tottenham Court Road, okay? And those days, we could actually stand on the platform of the buses. And as I looked out, on my left side, who should be coming? Joe Harriott. Now, I had this terrible urge to get off the bus, go and shake hands with him. But unfortunately, I was too well brought up. I didn't do that. And forever and ever, it's been my regret. And coming today is almost a kind of, you know, solace that at least I was here, at least to know more about the man. And at that time, although I'm not musical, I love to listen to jazz. I've listened to a lot of the British jazz musicians. I had a great friend who introduced me. The names you mentioned, and also Ian Carr, John Sermon, and all these names. It doesn't mean very much to my husband, but he has been listening to jazz. One more acolyte. Thank you very much, and it's been a great evening for me.
Oh,
I would not have missed this for the world.
Thank you.
Thank you. Beautiful.
Any other questions? Yes.
Do you know whether Joe Harriott is well known in Jamaica?
Should be perhaps better known, but he is being discussed and appreciated. I mean, Alpha Boys School existed in some form when I went to Jamaica about 10, 12 years ago, and they were doing jazz courses and stuff there and quite keen to inculcate a new generation of young Jamaicans in jazz music. So he is still very much an icon, but like most jazz icons, he could probably do with more celebration of them. I was just thinking about your story, and anecdotally, I just find Joe Harriott's headspace really resonates with me. You know, on the one hand, there's a story about two women just sort of having a massive catfight over him at Ronnie Scott's. Yeah, this is all in the biography. And you think, God, what? I can only imagine living that sort of rock and roll life, just playing jazz.
Do you envy it?
I don't know if I do, actually. I don't know if I need that in my life. But anyway, that sort of celebrity to obscurity the next second. Do you know what I mean? Sleeping on somebody's sofa. There's a neurosis. I mean, everybody remarks on how he'd bite his nails down to the quick. He would keep a wall up. So even if you were to get off the bus, I was thinking, and shake his hand, you might not have gotten the embrace that you might have expected. I think when you do, as I said, as a black jazz musician, intersect with racism on a daily basis, and I can only imagine what that was like in the 60s. The stories I hear about his interactions with Tubby Hayes, not always being good, for example, you know, make you sometimes abrasive. But you can hear the love, you can hear the warmth in the sound of the saxophone, and that, you know, and in the music that he created, and that thankfully stands the test of time.
What's the next Joe Harriott album we should listen to? If Abstract is a first for us, well, it is first for me. I don't know about that many others, but
In this context, or just generally, I'd definitely say Freeform. If you enjoyed this album, listeners who enjoyed this album may also enjoy Freeform. But all of them, the Michael Garrick recording was put out on his own record label, and it was just called Genius. That's interesting. There's the Tony Levin live in Birmingham recording where Harriott's just playing the proverbials out of the saxophone, which I like hearing, you know, and then Indo-Jazz fusion. So I think to hear the full gamut of what Joe Harriott was about, to hear him really nailing changes and playing bebop inside out, diagonally, upside down, is important. His own musical contributions to the world include Freeform and Indo-Jazz fusion, so they're definitely worth checking out, respectively.
And I want to talk just quickly about your own musical contributions. What are you working on now? Where are you playing next? And of course, we can listen to you on BBC Radio 3 as well.
Oh, yes. Giving my opinions on jazz every week. Well, there's two things, actually. If we're out of here in enough time, I've got my first televised documentary on Tonight.
Oh, fantastic.
Which is all about jazz, believe it or not.
On which
it's
channel?
Called Jazzology, and it's on BBC Four at 8 p.m. tonight. So if you don't make it home, set the iPlayer to watch it when you get back.
Well, that's great. I will be watching that, definitely. And how about musically?
It contains some of my more polemic ideas about jazz in it. And there's even more where that came from, so let me know what you think online. What was the other thing?
And what are you working on musically?
Good question. Given a lot of the stuff around the centennial end of the First World War, for a while I've been thinking of a piece to reflect the innovators of the period and the incredible stories of the period. So recently I had a good chat with Jason Moran about our mutual hero, James Reese Europe, Eugene Boulard, Samuel Coleridge Taylor, who I've mentioned already today. So I'm interested in creating a piece to debut next year that celebrates, I guess, the birth of a global black identity. There's no other way of really putting it. It's the sort of burgeoning of Garveyism, of an awareness, I guess, of black creatives around the world that they have a common sort of musical language. Mm-hmm. That's quite a powerful moment. And also to contrast the jubilation of the end of the First World War with the fact that there was a mutiny in Taranto with the black soldiers left behind. So many black soldiers from, you know, colonial soldiers, either Sikhs or West Indians or West Africans, were left behind to pick up, to clear corpses and clean all the debris. So there were race riots as well when these demobbed black soldiers returned to Chicago, to Cardiff, to all over the world. So I think that's a really interesting moment, and hopefully we're not going to repeat it.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting because that's a story I haven't heard, and it's not being taught in schools. This is really a great way to bring it up, and through music as well. Soweto, thank you so much for making your way all the way here.
So glad I did. I was just,
it's been great. It's been so great speaking with you, and thank you so much. And please give Soweto Kinch a big round of applause.
Follow me on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you.
And I'm Colleen Cosmo Murphy from Classic Album Sundays. I want to thank King's Place. I want to thank the EFG London Jazz Festival. But most of all, I want to thank all of you for listening. Thank you very much, and hope to see you again.